Well, thank you for your worship. Always enjoy being with you and hearing you sing and worship the Lord. We have a special guest with us today who is pretty special, but not really a guest. Paul Rankin is going to be coming to speak to us today. Paul actually graduated from Lee back in 2002, so he's kind of old, but don't tell him I said that. He is a minister. He's a business owner. Came back to Lee, did his master's degree here, and he was actually an RD. In fact, for a little while, he was pretty good on the athletic field with rehab, which is the old guys team in football, and with the staph infection in softball. And Paul was actually the guy that came up with the name staph infection for softball. So he's been entrenched in the league culture for a long time. He's a great man of God. He's currently one of the youngest franchise owners for Chick-fil-A, operating a franchise in West Virginia. He's one of us and a member of our family, but would you welcome Paul Rankin as he comes to speak to us today?
Hey, it's an honor to be here. Chapel Band is still crushing it. Awesome. I enjoy worship. I loved worship when I was here, but you guys did amazing today. Thank you, Pastor Jimmy and Dr. Mike Hayes. And thank you for being here. This is the week before convocation. And when I was here, we would call it conviction. It's about to get serious on campus. The Lord is about to speak to some hearts. So here's what I'll do today. I will promise you that I will bring energy. I'm a passionate guy. Hey, guys, I can see you here today. I might, like, jump on somebody's lap today or, like, grab somebody's neck. I will bring passion, but you've got to give me something today, okay? You got to work with me. So if I talk, you got to be engaged. You got to be into this today because I know that there are times where it's like, okay, I was up hanging out till 3 o'clock in the morning. I've only had one cup of coffee, and it's 10:40, and the lights are low, and who's this guy up there speaking? He's talking about chicken. Just out of curiosity, who has ever eaten at a Chick-fil-A? Okay, awesome, all right. Who has not eaten at a Chick-fil-A? Seriously, raise your hand. Okay, there's going to be an altar call after service. We'll be talking over here. We'll have a special prayer meeting because if you have not eaten Chick-fil-A, you are missing. And in fact, I'm assuming that that will be the dinner at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Waffle fries, sweet tea, somebody talk to me. Pickles, no pickles, what? So I'm just going to share a little bit of my story. And then, so I was a pastoral ministries major. How does a pastoral ministries major own a Chick-fil-A? I have no idea. You have to ask God about that. But I did. I came to Lee and I loved it and I had a fantastic experience. I went and I was a student ministries pastor for 6 years and I got kicked out of a church because they thought I was too crazy. No, not really, but I was there for 6 years and then I came back and I was a resident director for 3 years. Had an awesome experience again here at Lee. And then God has always had inside of me this entrepreneurial spirit, this passion to make money, but yet use money for God's kingdom. So there's always been this, okay, I love people and I want to lead people to the Lord, but I also don't want people to see go broke and die and go hungry. And he's always given me some weird ideas and it's always been inside of me. So when I was in ministry, I always had this itch to go into business for myself. And we launched out in faith and God opened the door. And it's been an unbelievable experience. Chick-fil-A is a great company. So part of my passion, I want to just... First of all, some of you are like, well, you know, who is this guy? I just want to throw a picture of my family up here because sometimes you would wonder, who's that guy? So the beautiful lady over there is my wife, Kara, and I want to honor her today because everything she does at my house makes it possible for me to be here today and for me to run a business. And she is the hero of my home. And then I've got a couple kids there. Callie's 8 and Eden is 6. And then Luke, we finally got our boy. We're going to raise him up to be a Buckeye fan. Come on, any Buckeye fans? Where's my Roll Tide fans? Oh, they're still in misery, right? They lost. Sorry. And that's Luke. So we're going to raise him up to be a huge sports fan. But more importantly, he's going to be a champion for the kingdom of God because that's what it's about. So that's my family. That's me. But my story, when I came to Lee, I was passionate to be here. Because at the young age of five, in 1986, we decided to go on a family vacation. Well, actually, my parents decided to go on a family vacation, and they decided to drag us kids with them to Pigeon Forge, Tennessee. Who's been to Pigeon Forge? You know, it's just right up the road, right? So we lived in Ohio, and, you know, nothing's more exciting than to go to Pigeon Forge, the home of Dollywood, right? I guess. But so we're on our way, and I was 5 years old, and I was super excited about the water slide that was across the road. We park, and my parents are telling us all about this, so the excitement's building. We're really excited to get at the water park, and I'm looking across, and I just take off. So my parents have me by the hands, and I just break free, and I look, and I say, you know, water slide parents, water slide parents. My parents are yelling to come back. There's 8 lanes of traffic. Paul, come back. Paul, come back. And I dart ahead, and right before I get to the edge of the pavement, I get hit by a truck going 45 miles an hour. Threw me 20 feet in the air, ran over me. I look down, and legs are outside of, or my bones are outside of my legs, and I go unconscious. And my parents, sure enough, know they've just watched their son die. Now I have kids, and I get that feeling a little bit more. But my dad, who actually came up today, and my parents came to Lee, they said that there's just never been a worse feeling than to watch that occur because they knew I was dead. But God's hand was upon me. And I didn't die that day. And 4 inches more, it would have been over my organs. And it would have killed me instantly. But thankfully, it just shattered my pelvis and my legs. And I actually have a picture so you know that I'm not one of those Pentecostal preachers who make up stories. So yeah, that kid right there is me. And that's a sweet vehicle back in the day. That was vintage 86. So the doctor said, this guy, you'll never walk again. Your legs, they're done. You know, like I said, I should have been dead, but by the grace of God and the mercy of God, I'm here today. So part of the passion that I bring to this stage today, part of the energy, part of the zeal, is because the Spirit of God lives in me, but because I understand the value of every day. I understand that every day, and when I came to Lee, and when I decided I was going to be an RA, and I was going to be in a social service club, and I wanted to be a chapel usher, and I wanted to deliver pizzas, I wanted to have an on-campus job, and then I sometimes wanted to go to class. It was, I wanted to soak up 8 years in my 4-year experience. In fact, my last semester, don't ever do this, I took 23 credit hours because I had a goal to graduate on time. And the last one was second year, second semester, New Testament Greek. I was crazy. I didn't sleep because I knew that life is special and I valued the bonus of every day, every month, every week. And if I were to sit down, and now it's Dunkin' Donuts, used to be Jasmine's when I was here. If I was to hang out with you, you would tell me that you get it too. That you understand that this season of your life, that this semester, that this time that you're here is a gift of God. Most of you understand that. Now, there are occasionally a student who will come and they have no idea that, you know, they're spending a lot of money and it's starting to act up. Nobody wants to be here for 4 semesters and to drop 60 grand and only have 4 credit hours. That's not your plan. So you understand the value of what it means to be a good steward. And I think God feels that way. In fact, I know He does. Because there's nobody on the face of this planet that wants to be more productive and wants your life to count more than God for His kingdom. I can promise you that. So if you're searching and if you're that last semester senior, or if you're here as a freshman and you're trying to figure out what am I going to do, let me just assure you that God's plan for your life is no more important to anyone else but to God. He's not trying to hide it from you. It's not some mysterious thing that He has hidden in South Africa that you got to go find under a ship or something. God wants to reveal His plan, His destiny for your life. And I think at some point, most of us in this room will get it. You might be in your 30s. For me, I didn't wake up one day and say, you know what? You know, you played this game when you're a kid. What do you want to be? I used to work at Kanakuk camps. I don't know if anybody's ever been to Kanakuk out in Missouri. It's a Christian sports camp. We would work the summers there when I was a college student. And we would play this game called Who's Your Daddy? And the game called Who's Your Daddy was, it basically was a camp where it was a sports camp where all these kids had influential parents. So us counselors were just curious, you know, who was around the fireplace? And some of them would be like, well, yeah, my dad, he's one of the top executives at Yahoo. My dad is Oral Hershiser, a professional baseball player. My dad is Michael Singletary. So all these kids would tell us who their parents is. And then occasionally one kid would be like, my dad's a pastor. You know, like, it's okay, your dad's a pastor. That's awesome. But I don't ever get the sense, you know, that God's call and that God's will for our lives, that we, most of us don't know that when we're sitting around the campfire. I had no idea that I would one day, you know, be a Chick-fil-A owner operator. That was not my passion when I was a kid. And in the scriptures and in Genesis, there's a very familiar story that I think speaks to what I'm talking about today, about living a steward's life, about having a dream and having a passion. And as I said, I think you'll figure it out whether you're 17 and you already feel like you know, or whether you're 35 and you eventually figure out. There's a moment in our lives where we feel and understand the call of God. And then after that, after we get it, we combine our gifts, our talents, our passions with God's passion for us. The task then now is to steward that dream. So if you have your scriptures today, we're gonna look at Genesis. And I'm just going to give a quick recap, because this could be like an hour and a half sermon if we read all the scriptures. But the story of Joseph, basically there was a 17-year-old man named Joseph. And Joseph was given a dream by God. It was not Joseph's dream. Joseph did not conjure up this, you know what, I want to be powerful, I want to rule over my brothers and my father. But he was given this kind of disturbing dream. I mean, can you imagine the concept of you looking around and saying, you know what, I feel like there's this dream that God's given me, and my brothers are bowing down to me, and it just is kind of a weird dream. So Joseph has another dream, and it's this same dream. It's like, okay, in essence, I'm going to be the ruler over those who are around me, my siblings. Now, some of you are thankful that you don't have siblings. Some of you like your siblings, but imagine that if you were Joseph and you had siblings and they decided to get really jealous of who you are and they would throw you in a pit. Now, some of you get frustrated when you go home and your younger sibling is hanging out in your bedroom. You wouldn't do well if your siblings decided to bury you in a well. Okay, that's not like a good family conversation around Christmas. He doesn't come back. You know, he's done. He's gone. So he has this dream, and I find it interesting that God shares this crazy far-stretched dream out in the future to a 17-year-old kid. And I find it interesting when we look in the New Testament, God's still passing out dreams and visions. He does it with a fantastic woman, Mary, the mother of Jesus, a young woman. He says, and an angel appears and says, I have a dream for you. It's far-fetched. You're going to be a virgin. I'm going to give you the savior of the world. I don't know about you, but I've not received any recent dreams like that. It's out there. It's a far concept. So then you've got to figure out, how am I going to steward that? And here's the deal. I think God is still giving those dreams out today. I think in this room, if I were to look at you fellas, if I look at you over here, look at you guys up in the balcony, and we got to spend some time and we got to look at your gifts and your passions. Some of you love athletics. And you think, how in the world can dunking a basketball make an impact for the kingdom of God? My favorite sports player of all time growing up, basketball player, was David Robinson, the Admiral. I'm a huge Spurs fan. But when I look at David Robinson's life and the platform that he has because he could dunk a basketball or he could swat people into the 15th row, it gave him a platform. You know, and Chick-fil-A for me is a platform to talk about the things that I love talking about. I love talking about mentoring young people, the next generation. I love talking about the kingdom of God. Truett Cathy was our founder, and he said, our mission is to have a positive influence with anyone that we come in contact with. Anyone. Now, sometimes confrontation, you think, well, how can that be positive? Well, if I sharpen you and I make you better, confrontation is a positive influence. I don't always have to be nice to you. In fact, I fire people monthly, and I kind of enjoy it. Because some people weren't made to sell chicken. That's not their passion. And my goal, and hopefully your goal in life, and God's goal certainly, is to get people where they need to be. So let's talk about stewarding some folks. One quick story before we read Genesis 39, 2 through 5, if you're on your YouVersion app or if you've got your scriptures. When I was 6, shortly after this accident, just to kind of tell you about this creepy business thing that God's always kind of put in my spirit. Most kids, when they're little, their parents or grandparents give them some cash and they immediately run to the store and buy a toy. Well, my grandfather, when I was 6, gave me $5. Now you can't buy anything for $5, but back then you could go to Sam's Club and you could buy a bucket of Now and Laters for $5. So that's exactly what I did. I went and bought a bucket of Now and Laters. Now, most of you kids would just sit down and you'd eat all those Now and Laters, but not me. I decided that I was going to open a mobile concession stand out of my book bag. And I realized at an early age, I could turn $5 into $25. And I could even eat a few pieces of Now and Laters. In fact, I was also helping the dental industry, because it was amazing as I was opening this concession stand and kids' teeth were falling out and their six parents are like, what in the world's going on? Oh, this kid over here is selling all this candy. That's what's going on. But I understood early on that I had some passion and some gift to sell some things. And I began to understand later on in life that it was okay not to just be a minister from the pulpit, but to be a minister in the pew. And to be a minister in the workplace. Because everywhere that I've went, I've worked with high school kids and college kids. Because my ministry in life is to make the next generation better than me. So if you're here today and you think life is about you, we can meet back in the green room and I could talk to you for about 10 minutes and I could kick you in the rear end. And then hopefully you'll live and you'll leave differently today. Because life is not about you. Joseph, Genesis 39, 2 through 5. He has this dream. His brothers decide that they're going to throw him into a pit. Some of his brothers wanted to kill him. They really didn't like him. Joseph is sold into slavery, and here we pick it up in 2 through 5. The Lord was with Joseph, so he succeeded in everything that he did. Somebody say succeeded. In everything he did as he served in the home of his Egyptian master. Potiphar noticed this and realized that the Lord was with Joseph, giving him success in everything he did. So this pleased Potiphar. So he soon made Joseph his personal attendant. He put him in charge of his entire household and everything he owned. And from the day Joseph was put in charge of his master's household and property, the Lord began to bless Potiphar's household for Joseph's sake. All his household affairs ran smoothly, and his crops and livestock flourished. So here is a slave, had a raw end of the deal. His brother sold him out. And what's he doing? He's serving. He's serving in a foreign land, in somebody who actually possesses him. He's under someone's slave. He's in bondage. But Joseph, and here's the first point, the first thing that I want to tell you, stewarding your dream, getting to where you want to go, the first thing that you have to do and that I have to do and I'm continuously working on is you have to be a steward of your mentality. You can control the way that you think. You can control the way that you respond to your situation. So here's Joseph, who was sold out. And you know what? Joseph made the decision. He had a stewardship mindset of the way he thought. He said, if I'm going to be a prisoner, I'm going to be the best stinking prisoner that has ever been created. And if I'm going to be a Lee student, I'm going to be the best Lee student that I can possibly be. And if I'm going to be a chicken slayer and sell some chicken, my goodness, I'm going to be the best chicken man out there. I'm going to be the best that God's called me to be. Some of you who are just barely making it to any classes, what are you doing? Wake up. It's great to have a social life, but you're here to have some school, to get an education. You can control the way you think. You can control your mentality. So I don't know if you enjoy swimming. I occasionally will go swimming. We'll go on a trip. We'll go to a hotel, and I've got some kids, as you saw. I don't really take swimming seriously until I get in the pool with my 8-year-old daughter. My daughter, Callie, is ultra competitive. And all of a sudden, my mindset and my mentality switches when I get in the swimming pool with my kids. And I'm like, I think I'm Michael Phelps. I'm in the pool, and Callie's beside me. And I'm like, all right, let's go. Let's go. And she's 8 years old, and I like want to dunk her underwater. And all of a sudden, I'm just like, I'm blowing out of the gate. And here she is, and I'm looking. I'm like, there's no way. And then I get to lap two, and I'm like, I'm not a swimmer. But my mentality, when I get competitive, my mentality changes. You see, there's going to be a moment in your life where you will be in a situation where you're overqualified for. I mean, look at Potiphar. He looks at Joseph and says, how in the world is this guy my prisoner? This guy is way overqualified to be a prisoner. This guy, the gifts and the talents this guy has, he has leadership qualities. And what happens is his master begins to see the potential that this guy has, and he begins to utilize his talents and his gifts and his skills. Why? Because Joseph had a mentality that where I'm going to be, I'm going to produce where I'm planted. So he began to produce, and he began to gain favor. In fact, if you read the story out, every time Joseph was thrown into slavery, he was given favor because Joseph had a stewardship mentality. He said, wherever I'm going to be, I'm going to be that best person. I'm going to be in that best position. I'm going to be exalted, not because I'm who I am, because it's God working through me. And let me tell you here today, there are some of you who have got so many gifts and so many talents, and you're feeling like, man, people don't notice. Someone will notice. I had a lady who just recently worked for me, who'd been with our company for 5 years, and we live in an area in West Virginia where actually D.C. Sends out some FBI plants across in case there was a catastrophe. They want to have information spread throughout the world, and we have one of those places. We've got an FBI facility about 5 minutes from my restaurant, and a lot of our lunch folks are FBI folks, and Susan, one of our fantastic cashiers, would serve these guests with excellence, and they would come in, and Susan would smile. And if you've ever been to a restaurant and at Chick-fil-A, and if you'd certainly be at mine, we use this language. We say the concept of how may I serve you, or I can serve the next guest in line. And Susan was just doing that faithful. Susan is way overqualified to be working for me, but I was so thankful to have her. And finally, somebody noticed at the FBI office, and they hired Susan away from me, and I was more than glad to give her away because that was a dream and a passion of hers to work there. But they noticed her because of the way that she served people. What kind of mindset can you have? You can have a servant mentality. Service is contagious. And unfortunately, it was so contagious that somebody in that position noticed Joseph. You know who it was? It was the one person in that place that Joseph couldn't touch. It was his owner's wife. And I look at this story, and this story, we don't ever get the concept that this was an easy decision. We don't ever know exactly how attractive or unattractive Potiphar's wife was. We don't get the sense of that it was an easy decision. But I love the way this story goes down, because another thing that Joseph stewarded with his mentality was he knew what did not belong to him. He knew that she was not his possession. And if you'll allow me, I think you know my heart well enough where you've been hearing me speak, and you know my passion and my love for students. But I know a struggle for many people at Lee is the relationship, stewarding relationships. You know, God wants us to have a steward mentality, and he wants us to, you know, to steward those relationships, whether it's the good friends that we surround ourselves with, or if it's the members of the opposite sex. And I want to ask you today, what's your mentality toward the opposite sex? Do you view that relationship that you're in? Is it, does this belong to you? Is she yours, or does he belong to you? Do you have that concept, or do you have the understanding that that could be someone else's future wife? Do I have so much respect for that person, or am I not just gonna be involved in something just for temporary pleasures that could be damaging for long term and have long term damaging results? Do you care enough about that person to steward them past you? Or are you caught up in selfishness? Do you serve and say, you know what, they don't belong to me? What kind of mentality do you have toward your relationships? What about the way that we speak to those around us? You see, Joseph had an understanding that things didn't belong to him. What about your finances? Do you swipe credit cards? Did the lady at Starbucks know your name, your order, and what time you're going to be there? And if they do, that's okay if you can afford it and if that's how you want to spend your money. But if you're going into debt every day for Starbucks, I would encourage you to go into debt at Chick-fil-A instead. You see, what great stewardship does in a steward mentality is it puts you forward. And eventually, Joseph obviously was promoted. Unfortunately, he was promoted because of a right decision that he made. But his promotion, when you think, wow, he wasn't promoted, he was thrown in prison. Well, absolutely he was promoted. Because the next prison that he landed in got him closer to his destiny. You see, because he was just at Potiphar's house, but Potiphar was so sick and tired of the accusation and what he thought he did and the frustration of somebody who he thought he could trust that betrayed him, he said, I'm going to make him a king's prisoner. And what he didn't know is that he was throwing Joseph around some influencers, around some people who had been in the presence of the king. And when Joseph's long-term dream and the vision that God gave for Joseph was to be a ruler, not for Joseph's gain, but to help Egypt, it got him closer. So here's the second thing to get to your dream. And I better read this in 39:20. So he took Joseph and he threw him in the prison where the king's prisoners were held. And there he remained. But the Lord was with Joseph in the prison and showed him his faithful love. And the Lord made Joseph a favorite with the prison warden. Why was Joseph a favorite? Because Joseph wasn't negative Nancy in prison. Joseph wasn't all beat up about his circumstance. Joseph was a steward of his mentality. Here's the second thing you got to steward is you got to steward your heart. Scripture tells us that if you guard, you have to guard your heart, for out of it flows the wellspring of life. He never let bitterness bankrupt him. He never let that consume him. He never let the fury and the passion and the bad memories. And you see, Joseph was thrown in prison at 17. He didn't get to his vision until he was 30. 13 years of misery. He didn't allow that to control him. Some of you want to manage large companies. Some of you want to manage churches. But right now, in this point of your life, you can't even manage your Facebook account. You can't even lead it well. God's asking you to learn to control your emotions. I've read some things these last few months that, quite frankly, I felt like I had to go take a shower after I would read them. People so lit up about stupid things. We got people dying and going to hell, and we get mad about this, that, and the other. And then you act like we're gonna change something by venting. You know what you're going to change? You're going to change somebody's perspective and your opinion of you that you can influence for the kingdom of God. You better get that junk under control. Whew. Man. I didn't even start it on Twitter, but I don't have a handle. So, man, let the Holy Spirit eat you there. Speak to your heart right there. I've been there. Listen, this isn't my final stop in life. I've not arrived. I've got future dreams and visions. So you better believe I'm still trying to steward my mentality. You better believe I'm still trying to manage my emotions. And there have been times that I faltered, and the Holy Spirit's quickened me and say, Paul, what did you just achieve? Whose mind did you just change? Okay, you got one person in your corner now who thinks like you, and you got a bunch of other people who think you're a stinking idiot. My passion and my heart for you is for you to have influence, a positive influence in everything that you do. Because what happens if God's speaking to you now and you learn how to control your anger and your emotions when you get into a situation and you've got to do something, and maybe you got to make a tough decision, you're under control. Proverbs 29:11 says, and this is my favorite 29:11, not the other one. This says, a foolish person lets his anger run wild, but a wise person keeps it under control. Would Joseph have been justified to lash out? Would he have been justified to ruin his brothers when they one day stood in front of him and his dream was realized and he could have ruined their lives? Absolutely. But would God have been glorified? No. There are times where I feel like I'm justified, but I got to ask, is God glorified if I respond that way out of my emotions? I have a picture here of when I was a student. There are times where you make bad decisions, and that was one of my worst ones. It was at a 70s night, and that thing floats around the internet, and Mike still has that. But I decided it was cool to dye your hair, and for a season of my life, I was going around as a blondie. And that was at a TKO 70s night, I think, there. But man, I look and I'm like, why didn't I have a friend look at me and say, what are you doing? Like that, honestly, you look like an idiot. But there's a difference between making a bad decision in dress and a bad decision with alcohol or a bad decision with a relationship. And what God wants you to do when you learn to control your emotions is that what comes in your heart and you begin to guard your heart, you begin to make wise decisions. And those decisions, if you stack up enough good decisions in a row, all of a sudden you're at a place and you look around and you say, how did I get here? It could not be but by the grace and the favor of God. And by somehow somebody pulling me aside and say, don't do that. That's not going to get you where you go. You see, if you continue to make wrong decisions, you know what happens is you stay in Potiphar's house. The goal is to get away from that and to get where you need to go. The story's different if Joseph entertains Potiphar's wife. Maybe they go to exotic island and live together forever, and then we don't ever hear about Joseph again. But we do know Joseph got where he needed to go because he made a wise situation. Last thing is you got to be a steward of your opportunities. So when Truett, our founder, came up with the chicken sandwich, he actually had two restaurants. One of them burned down. So it was in a time of struggle, and he had some time to think. And he said, Delta, I think Airlines was having, at that point, the chicken filet wasn't really used, so they were trying to get rid of it and figure out, you know, good use. So, you know, Truett said, well, I'm getting a good deal on this chicken. I can figure out a way to use it. So he began to experiment with the Chick-fil-A sandwich. And what was a rough time in his life, his brother had just passed away from a plane wreck, and his second restaurant had just burnt down. Now he had some time. And he began to think, how can I steward this opportunity? And in that process, he began to make the chicken sandwich. Now, nobody knew about the chicken sandwich, and some of you unfortunately still don't, and we can talk about that later. But the way, okay, he knew it was great. So Lyndon B. Johnson and his wife, the president's wife, were coming into town, and Truett came up with this way that he had to get before the president of the United States with a chicken sandwich. And he did. He used his influence to get in there and that they could try the Chick-fil-A sandwich. And you know, that wasn't just one thing, but many things along the way. Truett knew how to steward his opportunities. And I want to tell you that in your life, there are going to be things, even right now. So tonight, our men's and women's basketball team is on ESPN. You know what that is? It's amazing. It's an opportunity. And when 1,000 fans are packing the stadium and it's a whiteout tonight and people on television are watching and you're excited and you're excited and you're excited, people are watching. It's an opportunity. It's an opportunity to cheer us on for victory tonight. Come on, that's right. I have like 5 basketball fans in here. Awesome. The rest of you need to come out tonight. It's an opportunity for that, but it's an opportunity to show who we are tonight. And you're going to have opportunities all throughout life. You're going to have opportunities in this season. Are you going to manage your emotions? Are you going to steward your heart? Because what happens is Pharaoh eventually comes calling. And it's in Genesis chapter 40, 5-8. While they were in prison, Pharaoh's cupbearer and baker each had a dream one night, and they saw them the next morning. When Joseph saw them the next morning, he noticed that they both looked upset. "Why do you look so worried today?" he asked them. And they replied, "We both had dreams last night, but no one can tell us what they mean." I think I have this on there. So what happens is Joseph interprets their dream. Joseph takes the opportunity, and then 2 years later, because I have to wind down here, as Joseph's sitting in prison, Pharaoh has a dream. And Pharaoh calls his magicians around, and they're trying to figure out who's going to interpret this dream. And all of a sudden, the cupbearer remembers Joseph. Now, how did the cupbearer and the baker? So the cupbearer, I'm in the food industry, right? So the cupbearer is in charge of the drink. The baker is in charge of the food. I don't know how they ended up in prison. I don't know if they like served the king McDonald's instead of Chick-fil-A, and he was obviously extremely frustrated and kicked them into prison. But they were in prison. And Joseph stewarded his opportunity, and he answered the call. And 2 years later, the cupbearer said, "Oh yeah, I remember. I was supposed to tell you about this guy in prison." So Genesis 41, 15 through 16, and this is the end of the story. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I had a dream last night, and no one here can tell me what it means. But I have heard that when you hear about a dream, you can interpret it." But Joseph says, "It is beyond my power to do this, but God can tell you what it means, and he could set you at ease." Joseph was a steward of his opportunity. He didn't look at him and be like, "You know what? I've been in prison the last 13 years. I'm frustrated." No. He was serving. He had the mindset. And God used him to warn Egypt about a famine that was coming and that it was time to store up. And Joseph became a great businessman because he saved the nations around them as well from famine. You might be here today and you might think, "What does this have to do with me, Paul? You know, I'm just here to get my education." Because when I came to Lee, it was a lot about God crafting in me an education, but it was also a lot about God crafting in me character. And I want to encourage you, if you think you're here just for an education, I want you to allow the Lord to speak to you. And I want you to take this time to steward your thoughts, to get control of your emotions, because you're going to graduate, you're going to walk across this stage, you're going to get your Paul Rankin Bible from Dr. Kahn, he's going to shake your hand, and then it's game time. And you're going to get pushed out from this university to do what God's called you to do, to realize your dreams, to realize your vision. And if you're not ready, this world's going to eat you up. But if you've been a steward of this time and this season of your life, you're going to be the best servant that you can be in your industry. And they're going to look at you and be like, "Dude, you're way overqualified for this position. Let's give you a raise. Let's promote you because you've served. You've had a passion." So I want to ask you today to put this on the shelf of your heart. And I want you to utilize it. Let's pray together. God, I'm so humbled that you sent your son, Jesus, to be the greatest servant. God, to mirror what it means to come to serve and not be served, to give your life as a ransom. You sat with the disciples before you died and you washed their feet. And God, you are showing us and you are calling us to servanthood. God, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that, God, you would empower these students to serve. God, I pray that you would guard their mentality. I pray that you would guard their emotions and their tongue. And God, you would keep them from evil. And Lord, I pray that the passion of the Holy Spirit would work in their lives, God, to be kingdom people. Lord, I know that there are some students who are here today and they're thinking that this, it might not register with them now. But I pray, God, that before they leave, And before they go out in life, that God, you would be king of their heart and that you would be Lord of their lives. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would send out more people from this university to sing at inaugurations. I pray that you would put more people on The Voice. God, I pray that you would raise up some roaring lambs, some folks who go out into to theater, some folks who go out into the business world, some folks who go out into the church, some folks who walk into society and say, you know what? I am here to bring the kingdom of God to earth. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, that it would be so, not because it's my passion, but because it's the passion of the kingdom of God, and that these students would take it with them. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you so much, Paul Rankin. Nice to see everybody today. Hey, as he said, let us steward our opportunities tonight. ESPN, Lee University basketball against Union. Women play at 6, men at 8. Love to see you there. Also, convocation starts on Sunday night with Dr. Khan leading us off. Let me invite you every night at 6 o'clock. We'll have prayer here in the prayer rooms if you'd like to be a part of that. Also, a special U Church on Thursday. I think you've heard by now. Elevation Worship. Anybody excited about that? And then surely, just to start the marketing ball rolling, our special Lead Day guest this year, Bethel Music. So I know some of y'all would like to be a part of that as well. But hey, let's be excited about these opportunities that are coming forward. Again, tonight, basketball, ESPN, and also Sunday night, convocation begin. Please, let's stand and let's pray together the college benediction. Please pray with me. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Have a great day. Thanks.